alkali attack in the cement manufacturing process, the fundamentally important compounds required for the desired chemical reactions to attain the product are calcia, silica, iron oxide, and alumina. Examples of raw materials of these compounds are limestone, shale, laterite, clay, and so forth. These ingredients are mixed together and heated by various kinds of fuels. As a result, they react and become new types of compounds. Immediate temperature cooling is applied afterwards to transform these compounds into the desired phase to achieve the final product of pyro process, called cement clinker. Cement clinker is then mixed with other materials such as gypsum and various additives to make various types of cement. However, the raw materials and fuels, including both conventional fuels and alternative fuels, contain minor materials such as magnesia, various kinds of heavy metals, and volatile materials like alkali, sulfur, chloride, etc. The volume of volatile materials is based on the type of raw material and their source of origin. For instance, using a limestone source that contains high alkali results in an increase in alkali emission. Also, using both conventional and alternative fuels which have a high volume of sulfur and chloride also result in a change in their properties as well. The cement manufacturing process occurs from the heat transfer of fuel combustion from the main burner and the calcining burner. The raw materials are fed from the top of the preheating tower, with earth gravity causing them to fall down in the opposite direction of the incoming counter heat flow. In fact, this flow causes the circulation in the volatile substances currently embedded in the heat flow. These volatile substances are embedded in specific areas in the manufacturing system, including the cement clinker, burning atmosphere, and refractory lining. The main volatile substances that cause the problem in cement production and cause severe damage to refractory linings are alkali and sulfur. These substances can cause the damage either by themselves or together in the form of alkali sulfate. This accumulation damages the refractory linings in the following areas: the non-coating zone, such as the lower and upper transition zone, safety zone, and inlet of the rotary kiln; the calciner, riser duct, riser pipe, and bottom cyclone of preheating tower. As a result, the refractory suffers from both a rapid deterioration from the direct reaction with volatile substances and the infiltration of the substances to the inner layer of the bricks, where they accumulate and eventually cause the brick to crack and spall. Not only do the volatile substances cause damage to the refractory linings in each application zone, but they are also the cause of lower kiln productivity as they clog the cyclone and riser duct area. This occurs from the accumulation of cake or clogging material. Usually, we clean these clogging zones by applying pressured air or high pressure water. However, these solutions cause the surface of the refractory to fall off, which shortens the surface life of the refractories themselves. The circulation phenomena of volatile elements in a cement kiln can be explained by both raw materials and fuels generating these volatile elements into the cement kiln system. At high temperatures, such as in the sintering zone, alkali and sulfate evaporate to the gaseous phase of alkali gas and sulfur dioxide and move back to the inlet and cyclone. With the condensation temperature of alkali sulfate at about 700 degrees Celsius, alkali and sulfate can react and form alkali sulfate in liquid form. The liquid material is wet to raw meal and dust, resulting in the occurrence of build-up material in the riser pipe, riser duct, as well as in the cyclone, which might finally lead to the problem of clogging. After that, alkali sulfate in raw meal evaporates and accumulates and recirculates again. As for the effect to refractory materials, some of the gaseous of alkali and sulfate can also penetrate into refractory brick and transform into liquid and solid. Moreover, the volatile elements cause malfunction in the kiln's heat circulation. This results in production abnormality, such as unstable heat temperature in each application zone, which can cause a failure in coating. To avoid the problem caused by volatile substances, the cement products, manufacturing process and refractory materials, the amount of these substances are controlled within the level in this chart. The increase in the combination effect of sulfur and chloride can result in substantial clogging in the cyclone area, as shown in the diagram. Therefore, if we can properly retain these volatile substances in the kiln productions, the productivity of the kiln will be optimized. One of the parameters that is used in the production process to control the level of alkali and sulfur is the alkali-sulfur ratio, or AS ratio. By knowing the capability of both substances to cause a chemical reaction, we can calculate the balance of the substance reaction by the following equation. Given the desired par value as 1.2, both substances produce a full reaction and part of the sulfur reacts with calcium, which then results in the salt component of alkali sulfate and calcium sulfate. Some of them melt along with cement clinker and the rest evaporates as vapor in high temperature. These vapors are sucked back into the inlet and preheater zone by hot air. Also, they react with the raw meal. This balance in cement production atmosphere causes minimal disturbance to the cement kiln, both in production and deterioration. The controlled value of the AS ratio should be between 0.6 to 1.4. Using raw materials with high sulfur or alkali content may unbalance the AS ratio. When the alkali substance is too high, this causes serious reactions to the refractory products. As a result, they will become severely cracked. This shortens the surface life of the refractory products. This phenomena we call alkali attack, or alkali bursting. For burning zones that mostly use basic bricks, these areas usually accumulate salt from alkali sulfate. They are embedded deep in the refractory structure and become a densification layer and result in making a refractory crack on a layer of 50 to 70 millimeters and spalling. This also directly reduces the thickness of the brick's layer and makes their service life shorter. On the other hand, using fuels that contain high levels of sulfur, such as high sulfur coke, lignite, petroleum coke, and alternative fuels like used tires, may also cause an imbalance in the AS ratio, as using these kinds of fuels makes the volume of sulfur remain exceptionally high within the system. The high volume in sulfur impacts mainly on the refractory installed in the preheating tower by cleaning the clogging area. Also, at the burning zone that usually uses basic bricks, the sulfur attack disrupts the refractory bonding, which degrades the refractory heat tolerance. As a result, the refractory will become less heat tolerant and vulnerable to cracking and spalling. Moreover, the high level of sulfur may cause kiln shell corrosion from the salt acid of sulfate. For alkali attack toward fire clay and high alumina bricks, the half service life of Super Duty fire clay brick and high alumina brick at the inlet and safety zone of the rotary kiln can be dropped because raw materials or industrial waste with high alkali content is fed. Excess alkali reacts with the aluminosilicate structure at the hot face of the refractory and transforms to a lower melting point phase such as feldspartic materials. Refractoriness and strength of refractory bonding are reduced, resulting in a higher wear tear and shorter service life. Furthermore, the volume of the structure of refractory brick is highly expanded by about 20 to 40%, resulting in cracks and deep spalling. In the actual refractory application area, the upper transition zone in the rotary kiln is the most critical area for chemical attack on basic brick. This area usually has a high accumulation of alkali and sulfur. In addition, it is the area that has a high temperature with no coating, where both alkali and sulfur react with each other and become vapor and liquid of alkali sulfate salts. They infiltrate and accumulate within the brick. Also, since the cold face of the refractory bricks has a lower temperature than the hot face, due to the difference in their thermal conductivity, when the temperature of vapor and liquid of alkali sulfite salts When the temperature of vapor and liquid of alkali sulfate salts falls to the freezing level, they become solid, which massively decreases the porosity of the bricks within that area. This area is called the densified layer. It has a difference in the thermal expansion value, which makes the bricks crack and spall when the thermal fluctuation is high due to the unsmooth cement kiln operation. For example, when the kiln operation operates and stops consecutively, all of this is due to the fact that there are joint cracks between densified layers. Also, the damage caused by alkali attack causes the surface of the refractory brick to instantly lose thickness by 5 to 7 centimeters. This rapid thickness loss can result in red spots within the cement kiln. In addition, for basic bricks, such as magnesia chrome brick and magnesia spinel bricks, that have distinctive chemical properties infiltration, from conducting failure analysis by isolating sections, the results show that the hot face surface of the brick usually suffers from the infiltration of calcium silicate, which is clinker, or simply, silicate infiltration. The center core of the brick usually suffers salt infiltration from potassium sulfate, potassium chloride, or minimum sodium sulfate. In the cold face area, since potassium chloride is more capable of infiltration than potassium sulfate, it is able to deeply infiltrate the bricks if the bricks become thinner than their original shape. Therefore, to analyze the refractory damage after usage, especially from chemical attack, the bricks have to be analyzed by using special tools, such as X-ray diffraction and X-ray fluorescent spectrometry, to discover the root cause of damage. Although using the balance AS ratio is a very crucial factor to control the production efficiency and extend the service life of the refractory products, due to limitations of the sources of raw material and alternative fuels, the usage of the ratio has become less feasible. Some factories invest in heat bypassing systems to prevent the accumulation of volatile substances like alkali and sulfur. However, the downside of this choice is the high energy consumption, which incurs greater cost to the company. Upgrading refractory materials is another excellent alternative. Using the special refractory products that have higher tolerance to chemical reactions and infiltration, which extends the service life of the overall refractory products. And so, we have developed the following product lines that withstand alkali attack in each application zone. C6 series. Castable for riser duct, preheating cyclone and downpipe. PH40 AF. Brick for calciner, preheating cyclone and inlet zone. Chemresis, brick for safety zone. MS80 AF, brick for transition zone. Neomag S90, brick for coating zone. FlexDura, brick for retainer of outlet zone. TuffDura series, castable for outlet and burner pipe. Thank you.